One of the more intriguing and puzzling elements of the Book of Esther is the frequent references to drinking parties, and as the Gemara describes it in Tractate Megillah, that there is actually a command to become so inebriated that one not know the difference between cursed is Haman and blessed is Mordecai, which sounds, at least in a surface reading, like a very, very deep state of intoxication. And in fact, the Gemara goes on to say that it can easily get out of hand even in the ancient period. For example, at one Purim Suda, infamously, Rabbah got up and it says he slaughtered his colleague Rebbe Zeira, which is like, oh my gosh. Now, the Gemara goes on to say that when he saw what he'd done, he immediately prayed to God, a miracle happened, and Rebbe Zeira was revived. But then the Gemara, with its characteristic sense of humor, says that the next year, Rabbah says, hey, Rebbe Zeira, why don't you come by my place? We'll have a Purim Suda again. And Rebbe Zeira says, I'm paraphrasing, are you crazy? I'm not coming back to your place. A miracle doesn't happen every year. Like, we can't anticipate miracles will happen. At any rate, the idea of out-of-control behavior, perhaps connected to this drunkenness, is something that the rabbis consistently throughout time have excoriated. And there have been lots of limitations placed on how one should behave on the holiday of Purim, even within the context of this unusual commandment. Even Lubavitcher Hasidim, for whom communal drinking is often considered an act of worship in the sense of, you know, fostering communal connections and singing and joy and things like that, operate with a ban placed by none other than Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson on having too many drinks on Purim because of the many dangers that can result from excessive inebriation. So this is really a home-based holiday, no drinking and driving, God forbid, or anything like that. But it's interesting to note that besides that reference in the Talmud of Rabbah and Rebbe Zeira, we also have reference to this from the Romans and their legislation. The most fascinating passage occurs in the Theodosian Code. It was recorded in the year 438, and it was based on an earlier law that was dictated in the year 409 that specifically bans Jews from getting out of control with their Purim parties. And one particular behavior is especially excoriated, not drinking, because the Romans also like drinking quite a bit, that is burning Haman in effigy. It seems as well the Romans were especially concerned with the idea that Haman would not be hung as we tend to read the text today, but as they would have read it in the ancient world, that Haman would in fact be crucified. And in fact, this was the ancient way in which Haman's treatment was portrayed not only by Jews, by non-Jews as well. For example, in none other than Dante's great early 14th century Italian poem Purgatorio, Haman is described as being crucified. Michelangelo portrayed him that way on the Sistine Chapel. I mean, this is really the way in which non-Jews understood that Haman was killed. He was placed on a cross. So you can imagine the sensitivities if parties get out of hand and they have Haman in effigy and they decide to crucify him and then burn him. That could certainly lead to a lot of misunderstandings. And in fact, there is a whole book by Eliot Horowitz called Reckless Rites, Purim and the Legacy of Jewish Violence, published by Princeton in 2006, that goes through the history of these kinds of Purim parties and related things that go through time and the unfortunate backlash that Jews often suffer as a result. The Jews definitely got the word early on not crucifying Haman, but the burning of effigies of Haman, that certainly continued. For example, there's a 10th century Muslim scholar named Al-Biruni who refers to Purim as Suar Haman, or images of Haman, because that was the way in which non-Jews basically saw what was going on with these Purim parties. They did not see necessarily the little girls dressed up as Esther and little boys dressed up as Mordecai. They saw the effigies of Haman, which, according to a Cairo Geniza fragment from the 13th century, were apparently displayed for days before Purim. I mean, you would see the Haman hanging from a rope somewhere for 5-6 days before Purim, and that was definitely a very, off-putting image for many. Now, I think in the whole, this is a great moment to understand that this is a cautionary tale that we certainly want to celebrate on Purim, but we should do so definitely within the boundaries that our rabbi set for us. It's a cautionary tale for us about how these things can be misunderstood. Besides the many dangers that can result from excessive inebriation, we definitely want to explore the spiritual meaning of Purim. And to whatever degree alcohol assists in that, that's great. But beyond that, it's a very dangerous thing. Thank you very much for watching.